see, I'm going to try and reinforce some of the points that Maria made and really kind of expand on the dual impact of sea level rise and storms along the West Coast, but kind of talk about an approach that could be applicable to really to any coast worldwide. So we spent a lot of time in the last decade here at USGS and with partners along our coast, Point Blue, also with federal agencies, NOAA, and academics like OSU and Scripps, to develop a robust tool to look at the dual impact of sea level rise and storms. And there's a lot of societal relevance for this type of approach, particularly in the context of climate change. And I want to emphasize that we're not just talking about sea level rise, but also changing storm patterns and how these are going to place additional stresses on coastal systems worldwide. Looking at future population projections, over 1 billion people are expected to live in the coastal zone by the end of the 21st century. And this places the very sustainability of nations at risk. U.S. coastal counties generate on the order of $7 trillion to the GDP. And in California, by 2100, roughly 2 million people and over $1 trillion are at risk. And this would account for about 5% of our GDP. However, many hazards assessments are limited to the impacts of sea level rise and do not include waves, storms, and coastal change or groundwater impacts. And that's the niche we've tried to fill here along the West Coast using the coastal storm modeling system, which I'm going to introduce in a few minutes. Even though we're a sort of a different tectonic setting, we're in an active setting, mostly a high relief coast. However, most of the 27 million people living in coastal counties in California live in very low-lying areas, literally on the beach within estuaries. And so the risk is quite similar to many stretches of coast along the East Coast or Gulf Coast. Even in cases where we have heavily populated areas along the more high relief sections of the coast, people along the cliff edge, which are vulnerable. There's even a number of communities built below the bluff toe, below the cliff toe, literally on the beach. So the vulnerability is actually quite significant and similar to what you see on the East and Gulf Coast. In addition to this, we have lots of infrastructure along the coast. We have several nuclear power plants literally built right at sea level, lots of sewage treatment plants, and other critical infrastructure throughout the region that are at risk of flooding. Now, flooding really comes to a head on our coast during El Nino events. This is the end member of the El Nino Southern Oscillation. And just to refresh some people what this is, what happens is during an El Nino event, which is just the end member of this climate variability, this cycle known as El Nino Southern Oscillation, tropical winds relax or switch directions and blow to the east, and we get very warm water, a warm pool of water along the eastern tropical Pacific. And this is basically the fuel for mid-latitude storms that then strike our coast. And this results in elevated seasonal water levels due to the warmer water on the order of about 30 centimeters along the California and Oregon and Washington coasts. In addition, we see an increase in wave energy over the typical winter of about 50% and coastal erosion that can exceed 70% above the typical winter erosion, and more importantly, flooding and damages that can be in the billions of dollars. So work that we did prior across the entire Pacific suggests that while El Nino primarily affects the eastern Pacific, the southwestern Pacific is impacted at a similar level by La Nina, so this sort of oscillation between these two end members affects the main population centers across the entire Pacific. And future projections suggest there may be an increase in the frequency of these extreme El Nino and La Nina events, and so even without sea level rise, that's going to place these population centers at greater risk in the future. And one of the key points to make here is that these aren't just projections for the future. We've experienced these kinds of events in the recent past or the last several decades. In particular, the 1982-83 El Nino was one of the largest and most impactful events along the California coast, leading to extensive damages, flooding, many of the piers in Southern California sustained extensive damage and many were destroyed. but not only during El Nino events, during larger winter storms, we have lots of areas that are vulnerable and experience frequent flooding along our coast. And this is a photo just from my backyard here, a little less than a decade ago, from a sort of a larger winter storm, but not one that is atypical of the region. Now, in order to assess the impacts of these El Niños, we really rely on extensive topographic data collection so we can understand how the beaches are behaving, an extensive buoy network to look at the wave climate over the last several decades, and also water level. So having all this information in place lets us compare these El Niño winters to prior winters and really get a sense for the true impact. And so we had one of the largest events in the industrial age in 2015-16, along with the other really big ones we've had on this coast in 1982, 83, 97, 98. But during this event, winter wave energy equaled or exceeded observed maxima across the entire region. Winter beach erosion was the highest ever recorded. And in California, what was quite unusual about this event was that drought accompanied it. And so we had very little precipitation during this El Nino event, but we had very large waves. So we had extensive beach erosion, but the rivers, the catchments were not flowing, so we had very little sediment production. So it's kind of the worst case scenario almost in terms of the beaches themselves, with large waves eroding the beaches and very little sediment coming in behind to fill in. Now, looking to the future, you know, the big concern, of course, is sea level rise and the dual impact of sea level rise and storms. We know from the great work of Ramsdorf and sort of derivations thereof that global temperature increases are tightly linked to sea level rise. But really the concern is that sea level rise lags temperature increases because there's a very long response time of these ice sheets. And that's something that's sort of on the cutting edge right now, the state of the science, trying to understand how long it'll take these ice sheets to respond to temperature increases. But what's really cause for concern is that we have examples from the recent geologic past where we had much higher sea level rise with comparable amounts of temperature increase. For example, 125,000 years ago, during the last major interglacial, global temperatures were about 2 degrees warmer than pre-industrial today, but sea level rise was 8 meters higher, so roughly 26 feet. In addition, just toward the end of the Pleistocene, when we were recovering from the last glacial maximum 14,000 years ago, during one of the major meltwater pulses, sea level rose 20 meters in 4 centuries. So we're talking for 400 years, each century we had on the order of 5 meters of sea level rise per century with much less temperature increase than we're experiencing today. So that response time is something that we're really concerned about, and while there's so much research in Antarctica going on right now to understand how quickly these ice sheets can respond to these temperature changes. Take-home message, though, is that we have a lot of sea level rise already baked into the system. So with net zero future emissions, we're actually committed to about 1.7 meters of sea level rise already. And if we follow current trajectories of emissions through the 21st century, we're going to be committed to at least 9 meters more of sea level rise, so something like 30 feet. This isn't expected to happen in the next century, but the bottom line is that we're baking in a lot of sea level rise into the system if we're not going to reduce emissions. And that's a cause for concern as we move forward. You know, we're seeing now what Maria has noted on the East Coast, Gulf Coast, and we're seeing this on the West Coast as well, is that these instances of nuisance flooding are increasing. These sort of fair weather flooding events that occur during high tides, we're seeing more and more often throughout these low-lying areas of the West Coast, not only in Southern California, but Northern California and further north as well, like here along the Embarcadero in San Francisco. So these kinds of events, now that maybe we're only seeing once a month or several times a year, we're just going to see more and more frequently. At some point, these higher tides are going to become your sort of average daily tidal conditions, and that's where we're really going to see significant impacts. And the same token, looking at some of these storms that occur maybe every 5 or 10 years are going to start to be occurring every year or multiple times per year, leading to significant impacts to our infrastructure, our roads, our coastal populations. So what we've tried to do is develop an approach, a modeling system, to look at the dual impact of sea level rise and storms. You know, the NOAA Sea Level Rise Viewer is an excellent first-order approach for looking at the impacts of sea level rise and tides. That's a static approach. And what we've tried to do with COSMOS, the Coastal Storm Modeling System, is model all the relevant physics that contribute to total water levels during an extreme event. So on the West Coast, this includes seasonal effects, such as we experienced during El Nino, storm surge, which is quite small on our coast because we have a very narrow shelf. Locally, river discharge can be a factor, but waves are the big driver of coastal flooding along this stretch of coast and can elevate coastal water levels by 2 meters or more. So we want to develop a system that can include all these relevant physics that was forced by global climate models to look at the future wave climate and look at a full range of sea level rise and storm scenarios. All of this integrated with projections of long-term shoreline change and retreat of the cliffs themselves. So it's a dynamic model in the sense of the shoreline evolving and also in terms of the future wave climate and the storms that we're simulating. So this is developed for California so far, with applications being developed currently for Washington and Puget Sound. It's a physics-based system for looking at coastal hazards due to climate change. It predicts coastal hazards for the full range of sea level rise and storm possibilities, so virtually any planning horizon from your giant storm today to your worst-case scenario far in the future. And we try to use the most sophisticated global climate and ocean modeling tools. And in developing these tools, it's been done with a very close and extensive collaboration with governments at all levels to directly meet their emergency management and also future planning and climate adaptation needs. So the way the model works is that we integrate the forcing from global climate models, the winds, to develop a global wave model. We then dynamically downscale these winds, and then we bring in the storm surge, the tides, and all the other local factors that contribute to local water levels until we can scale all the way down to local hazards projections with a 2-meter resolution of the flood predictions on the ground. So we're scaling essentially from 200 kilometers at this global scale down to 2 meters on the local scale and bringing all the physics all the way down to this very local level. And a key feature of this work is how it is brought to the public through this web tool known as Our Coast, Our Future. And you can check it out here. Anyone can log in. And what it has is preloaded all these different scenarios, and it's a Google Earth interface, so it has all the imagery, and we've also bring in lots of other shape files of infrastructure, ecosystems, and other relevant factors. But you can look at flooding, you can look at waves, you can look at currents, you can look at storm duration, and you can pick whatever sea level rise scenario you want, whatever storm frequency you want, and look at the results. In addition, there's also options for looking at future projections of shoreline change and cliff retreat. What most people do on this site is they go in and find their area of interest. Here's an example from Santa Barbara, and they begin clicking through scenarios to try to identify where their tipping points are, where their infrastructure and populations are at risk, and be able to identify where that sort of timeline is when they really need to begin planning or what horizon need to be planning for throughout these different distribution of scenarios. Another key feature is that we've tried to very honestly and robustly convey the uncertainty of these models. All these models are going to be wrong, but we have a confidence interval within which we believe them to be accurate. And so depending on the sensitivity of your infrastructure, we have this uncertainty layer, which can give you sort of the worst case scenario given the maximum uncertainty of the model. Other features include duration of flooding during a 24-hour storm scenario. If an area is flooded just for a few minutes or for many, many hours, can have a significant impact on the vulnerability and eventual impacts on that site. We also produce maximum wave maps. If you're looking at, for example, harbor infrastructure and potential energy that's going to be expended on on these facilities. Also, we have wave and then tidally generated currents that we put out in this tool as well to understand sort of scour and harbors and things like that. So the other major feature is a complementary tool where we translate these what can be somewhat esoteric flood maps, for example here shown for the Bay Area, into something more relevant for policy people. And this is done in this complementary tool known as the Hazard Exposure Reporting and Analytics Tool, or HERA, and the website there is accessible as well. And so looking at this sort of flat flood map now, we can translate that into how many residents, how many billions of dollars in property at risk, roads, facilities, et cetera. So this example from San Francisco shows for this scenario on the order of 350,000 residents and $102 billion in infrastructure are at risk. And this is something that may raise the eyebrows more of a congressperson in your region than a simple flood map. So the take-home message from this collective work is that, you know, today's 100-year coastal water level is projected to occur every 1 to 5 years by 2050. All the coastal change work we've done on the West Coast suggests that because of the urbanized and fixed nature of our coastline, up to two-thirds of these beaches will be completely eroded by 2100. And the cliffs are going to be eroding up to 3 times faster. So it's not just the flooding, it's also the erosion of our coast and the acceleration of that erosion. Finally, we've tried to do some unique outreach, and here's just a quick example showing a virtual reality viewer, an owl that we developed for the Santa Monica Pier. The public can go up to these viewers, look through the viewer. They can look at the current beach, where the shoreline was before major nourishment was done across this region in the 1920s. And then they can see what this area would look like with sea level rise. And finally, a potential adaptation option to mitigate the impacts of sea level rise. So really the critical needs moving forward that policy decisions made in the next few years are really critical and will have profound impacts on global climate ecosystems and human societies for millennia. You know, nationwide, we need a more systematic approach to assess the impact of climate change, including storms in addition to sea level rise. But the accuracy of these models is dependent on observation, so it's critical that we continue the monitoring of waves and water levels and extensively and annually and seasonally map coastal change throughout the United States. So more information here is below, and I'll turn it over to the next speaker. Thank you.